I wasn't nervous until after that introduction. I don't know the man that he described. I'm just a simple man from South Louisiana. Born and raised. And I've had the privilege of seeing the Lord do many mighty things. So I'm grateful to spend this time with you, grateful for the opportunity to share with you from the Word of God. Renovation Church is one that we often describe as either reformatic or Presbycostal. And so, yes, right. So I was very pleased with the organ playing earlier. And when I get near the end of my sermon, if you could just find my key, then we'll go all the way in. I don't know if you're still over there, but if I decide to tune up, you just stay with me, okay? Though I would like to give you a theological treatise this evening for Romans 5 or 6 and explain to you how grace and works go together, instead, I'm going to turn to what we might find as an obscure passage in 1 Kings chapter 19. I believe that there's a lesson here for the heart of every minister. I believe that what the prophet endures in this season is one that many of you have endured in many seasons. And that's not a geriatric joke. That is the gift of wisdom. And it's someone that that even in a short amount of time, I have had the, and I will say, privilege to endure as well, because I am a firm believer that we are made our best selves in the furnace of difficulty. And on the other side are the great graces that God produces in our life. So we'll primarily be in 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 9 through 16. If you are willing and able, would you please stand for the reading of the word? And if you see me slouching too hard because of this tiny pulpit, just correct my posture with a wink and a nod. I hear the word of the Lord. At that place, he came to a cave and spent the night there. Then the word of the Lord came to him saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I've been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." The Lord said, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Now there was a great wind, so strong that it was splitting the mountains and breaking the rocks into pieces before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And he answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts. For the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." Then the Lord said to him, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael as king over Aram. Also you shall anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king over Israel. And you shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, of Abel-Meholah, as prophet in your place." The word of the Lord. Lord God, let the meditations of our heart and the words of our mouths be acceptable in your sight, our King and Redeemer. Would we be transformed tonight under the power of your word, leaving different men and women, we ask in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. And all of God's people said,
amen.
Please have your seat. 2010 was an interesting year for Brianna and I. We had been in Atlanta for nearly 2 years, but at that point had had little traction in actually seeing something take place that would one day be called Renovation Church. There were, of course, possibilities on the horizon, but so much had already been difficult. And if you would like to hear some of those horror stories, I'd be glad to share in a different venue. And I would only later see those possibilities in hindsight. In order to make ends meet, I took it upon myself to become an itinerant preacher. Work was not coming easily at that time, and I knew that God had, at the very least, given me the gift to communicate His word in a mildly effective way that would allow me to not only continue to hone that craft, but also provide for my family. One such opportunity was at a friend of mine's church named Jason Martin. We knew the people there well, they knew us well, they loved us well, we loved them well. And so when I arrived on that balmy Sunday morning, I made no special or unique preparations. I didn't think to myself that this is going to be a train wreck that I will have to clean up for months to come. I knew that I was amongst family, and all I had to do was get up and deliver the word of God and get out of the way. But trouble was on the way. From the start of the sermon, I could feel that something was off. Anybody ever been there? My thoughts were scattered, my points were disconnected, my passion was low. It was clearly not connecting with the people to whom I was preaching. In fact, the sermon was preached so poorly that at one point a woman got up off the front row, stopped in the aisle, shook her head at me, and then turned and went the other way. It's a true story. It was so bad that I had 3 pages of notes left. And I decided to just make a beeline to the gospel because at least I could get that right. It had no connection to the former point I made. And so that's why God wants to. And so then Jesus died for our sins because I just wanted to get out of the way. It was so bad that my friend Jason called me later that day, and he began to probe and ask me all of these penetrating questions. At first he asked me if I was okay. I said, yeah, I'm okay. He said, are you very stressed out right now? I'm a little stressed out. You know, church planning is a little stressed out. We were starting from scratch, started with 3 people in my living room. He said, do you have any secret sin in your life? Very seriously. I said, no more than usual. That's how bad I delivered this sermon. As you might imagine, as a man in my 20s at the time, I know I still look good to be in my 20s right now, it shook me. I began to question everything. I began to question my call. I began to question if I was supposed to plant. I began to question if I was supposed to preach. I began to question if I was actually anointed of God. I began to question if we were on a fool's errand. I began to question if I had wasted my time in school and wasted my life moving to this new city and wasted the job that I left behind that was comfortable in a large church like this one where I could hide and do my bidding and not wear the worry of the world on my back. I began to question everything, including the whole of my calling. And I believe I'm not alone in that. You see, we lose confidence in our calling when difficulty comes. It is the first emotion that we experience. When we get that email from that big giver who's leaving the church because we said something that they agreed with 5 years ago, but now they don't agree with. Or we get that email being accused of saying something that we didn't actually say, but by defending it, we only make it worse. Or we get that phone call from a family that we thought we were close to, and all of a sudden they no longer want to be close to us, and our children ask for their children and wonder where they went and wonder why they've left the church. And the list goes on and on and on. And you sit back in your office or in your home or in your car and you ask the Lord, am I actually called to do this? Maybe you got the wrong person. Now, perhaps you've had that golden Enoch ministry, and you're just waiting for the cherry to scoop you up. But for the rest of us, this is a reality with which we battle. In fact, one of my mentors, he's 68 years old, and he says that there is with regularity, he's still questioning if he's doing what it is that the Lord would have him to do. So how do we face that? How do we wrestle with the double-mindedness of knowing what God has said, but questioning if it still applies? How do we face the desire to withdraw or redirect or run? By reminding ourselves that God's calling is not deterred by difficult circumstances. In fact, God's calling may be to those difficult circumstances in order to refine the people that He is calling us to be, in order to prepare us to reach the people that He is calling us to reach. And in those moments of doubt, if we would simply submit ourselves to the calm voice of the Lord, He will be quick to reaffirm and to recommission the call that He has given every single time. Now, context, of course, matters, and I've been told I've only got 30 minutes, and so I will try to be brief. Where we find ourselves in the story of 1 Kings is in the continual case for God's people. Israel is once again plunged into idolatry, forsaking Yahweh, the one true God, and worshiping a false idol, Baal. Baalism spread quickly in Israel because Israel was an agricultural society, and Baal promised that he would be, in their purported belief of him, the one to control the rain and control the lightning and control the weather. So if we worship him, then we will have a bountiful harvest and we will be able to live the lives that we want to live. It also spread quickly because of political reasons. Because in an attempt to strengthen his position in the region, Ahab, Israel's king, made an alliance with the nation of Tyre, marrying Jezebel, the princess from that pagan nation. It sets the scene for one of the most interesting and, in my opinion, fascinating and emotional stories in the scriptures. It starts in 1 Kings 17:1. A man enters the narrative with no announcement, no pomp, no circumstance. He just shows up, and his name is Elijah, and he is one of the most distinctive and diversely talented people in the Bible. Write that down because it is important. He is a prophet, he is a preacher, he is a political reformer, he is a miracle worker, all at the same time. We would wish to be 2 out of 4 of those on any given day. But most importantly, he has a calling that cannot be cast aside. He must make it his mission to show the people of God that Yahweh lives, that Baal does not exist, and that how they live flows from what they believe about God. He barges into the plot line, an unknown man from an unknown town, but because of the power of his call, he walks right up to the king without any hesitation of any kind and says, "Hey, king, there's not gonna be any rain until I say there's gonna be rain." Now put yourself in that situation for a moment. First on the side of the king. I mean, I gotta be honest. My first thought would be, who does this fool think he's talking to? Off with his head, right? But put yourself in the position of Elijah. We are intimidated by powerful figures within our church. This is a king over a nation. And he walks right up to him and tells him that there will be no rain. Why? Because he believes the word of God more than he fears the opinion of man. Oh, there's a word in there for somebody tonight. Organ player, that's when you hit that C chord right there. There's a word for somebody tonight. That's when you... General Assembly 2020, we'll get it. We'll get it. Now, the choice of a drought is not incidental. You know that. You know that. Why? Because The choice of the drought invalidated the power of Baal's promise. If there is no rain, then the rain God cannot be real. Confident in his call, Elijah calls on God to do what only God can do, and God does. God takes the rain. Why? Because Elijah's trying to prove a point. God makes the rain. Now, after this encounter with Ahab, the narrative lurches forward as Elijah obeys God's call and goes to a place called Zarephath, which was located in Phoenicia, which was the very heart of this false religion called Baalism. There, Elijah meets a widow whose life has been so impacted by the drought that he prayed for that she only has left a bit of flour and a dab of oil and a few sticks of wood. In fact, 1 Kings 17, 10 through 16 tells us that she fully expects to starve to death with her young child. But Elijah makes a promise. Because God hears his prayers and has sent him to her, she will not run out of flour until the drought ends. Again, a lesson here, God makes provision when provision seems impossible. Let me say it again for those of us still raising money for new buildings right now. God makes provision when provision seems impossible. And so he says, in the context of this story, to the widow, that when Baal cannot provide for the people and for the land, God does. Thus proving in another sign that Yahweh is the living God and Baal is a dead idol. But as often is the case, shortly after the miracle comes malady. I could preach that right there all day. 1 Kings 17, 17 through 24, the widow's son becomes so sick that he stops breathing. And the woman fears that Elijah has come to actually judge her for her idol worship. And that is why her son is now sick, because Elijah's there to punish her. But Elijah's faith in the midst of uncertainty allows God to work through him to demonstrate God's life-giving power and his constant care and his incredible compassion, even amongst the people that were not his elect. Because Elijah believes God, and because Elijah is confident in his calling, he does something that would otherwise seem strange. He asks the widow to entrust her son to him. He takes the boy, he picks him up, he walks upstairs to the room in which he's staying, he lays the boy down, and then he lays across the boy and begins to pray to the living God. Oh Lord, my God, let this child's life come into him again. And God raises the boy from dead. Why? Because God brings life when life seems lost. 3 years go by. The drought having its full effects on everyone in the region. The famine caused by the drought was so severe that even the animals have nothing to eat or drink. And in the midst of it, God calls Elijah to go and meet again with the king, 1 Kings 18:1. Ahab, of course, is not happy to see Elijah. Why would he be? He calls him the trouble of Israel. But this is no matter to Elijah. He is confident in his call. Watch the theme. Confident in the Lord. He tells the king that it is he and his family that are actually the troublers of the nation. That it is their fault that the nation has been plunged into idolatry. In fact, Elijah is so confident in his call and confident of God's hands on him that he commands the king to summon all the people of Israel and all the 850 false prophets of the king and the queen to come to Mount Carmel, and there he would show them who the true and living God is. To accomplish his goal, Elijah proposes a contest, one man versus all, the living God versus man-made idols. What is the contest, we may wonder? A sacrifice will be offered up, 1 Kings 18:24. And the God who answers by fire is the one true God. The scene is set. Elijah invited them to go first, and the false prophets confidently took up their sacrifice and took up their challenge. In fact, if you read the story, it seems that only Elijah and the false prophets actually live with any conviction. But things do not go as planned. From morning until noon, the false prophets call on Baal. They beg that he hear them. They shouted, they danced around, but nobody answered, nobody responded. At noon, 1 Kings 18:27 tells us that Elijah began to taunt them. I believe this is a spiritual gift of sarcasm. God has granted me that gift and it has served me well these many years. Shout louder, he taunted. Surely he is a God. Perhaps he's in deep thought. Perhaps he's going to the bathroom. That's in the Hebrew, I'm not making it up. Perhaps he's out on vacation. Perhaps he's just busy. Maybe he's sleeping and must be awakened. Midday passed, and they did shout louder, and they began to cut themselves, and they spilled their own blood in hopes for a response, but to no avail. Now it was Elijah's turn. He told the people to help him rebuild the altar of the Lord. The prophet could not rebuild God's altar alone. That's another message. They then dug a deep trench around the altar. They filled four large jars with water. And in order to soak the altar and the wood and the sacrifice, three times they poured the water over and poured the water over and poured the water over, so much so that it actually filled the trench that they had dug. And then Elijah prayed, "Oh Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known this day that you are God in Israel and that I am your servant, and that I have done all these things at your word. Answer me, O Lord, answer me, that this people may know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you have turned their hearts back." And then without delay, fire fell from heaven. And when the fire came from heaven, it not only consumed the sacrifice, it consumed the wood. And it not only consumed the wood, it consumed the altar. And it not only consumed the altar, it licked up the water. And it not only licked up the water, but it burned the ground. Why? Because God brought fire for the people to see his absolute power. And they did, and they worshiped him. And shortly after this outpouring of fire would come an outpouring of rain. Elijah went to the king and he said, "Listen, now that you know that your false God has no power, now that you know that your false idol can do nothing for you, now that you know that there is only one God in Israel and his name is Yahweh, now God will bring the rain." The Bible tells us that a small cloud formed the size of a man's hand. And then all of a sudden, there was a drenching rain. And with the rain, God's victory is complete. Elijah's calling is confirmed. Now watch this. After all of that, after all of that victory, what's the theme? After all of that unstoppable display of God's power, after all of that confidence in his calling, because he trusted God more than he feared man, all of a sudden, in the very next scene, everything comes undone. Ahab went home and told his wife Jezebel, I call her Jazzy for short, all that had happened. 1 Kings 19:1. And so Jezebel sends word to Elijah that she wanted trouble, that a fight was coming, coming today. And she says this, "So may the gods do to me and more also, if I do not make your life as the life of one of them, her false prophets who died by the hands of the people of Israel for being false prophets by this time tomorrow." In other words, she will see to it that he is killed. And for a reason not fully revealed in the text, all of a sudden Elijah is gripped by fear. One threat undid everything that he saw God do. One threat made him question the weight of his calling. One threat made him begin to doubt God and believe this pagan woman more than the king of the universe. And I could go down the line. One call, one email, one stumble, one thing not coming together the way that we planned it to come together. One thing going sideways, and all of a sudden, God is nowhere to be found. When I read this, I began to ask myself, because that's what we do. We get judgmental. We get judgmental of the Bible. I mean, I'm positive that when I step through the gates of heaven, Peter's gonna walk up and punch me right in the face. Because I've been very hard on Peter over the years. Very hard. I'm like, how are you gonna swear to God you don't know God? Think about that. Let it hit you. It said he swore an oath. He swore an oath to God that he didn't know Jesus. And Jesus is. So you just swore to God you don't know. How bad you got to be to swear to God? I swear to God I don't know God. I've been hard on Peter. And so I'm reading this, and I'm doing the same thing to Elijah, and I'm saying, man, he was incredibly bold when God was under attack. Oh, somebody got it. But when he was under attack, all of a sudden, God's not enough. God is only unstoppable to the degree that his decisions match our desires. All of a sudden, he forgot that God stopped and started the rain. All of a sudden, he forgot that God kept the flour and the oil flowing. All of a sudden, he forgot that God raised a boy from death right before his eyes. All of a sudden, he forgot that God sent a fire so hot down from heaven that it burnt the ground up. All of a sudden, one word from a person caused him to question everything. Why? Because we are well-versed in defending a God who doesn't need to be defended. But when we come under assault, all of a sudden, maybe I'm just talking to me tonight. All of a sudden, the weight of the words of a person become heavier than the work of God. So what does he do? He runs. He runs. In fact, he became so devastated by this threat that actually he asked God to die. It's enough now, O Lord, take away my life. For I'm no better than my fathers. One moment of difficulty, and he forgot all the promises that God fulfilled. In fact, if you go read it for yourself, Elijah even dismisses his servant because he's discarded his ministry. Because he decides that it's done. Why? Because it's human nature. Because when we are faced with what we determine to be insurmountable difficulty or indiscernible confusion or indescribable pain, we allow fear to cloud our judgment and dull our faith. All of a sudden, it doesn't matter what God has called us to, our confidence is consumed by circumstance. All of a sudden, it doesn't matter what God has done. Fear outweighs our faith. And so what do? Like Elijah, we run. We may not physically run. We may not actually quit. We hide in ourselves, unwilling to face the fight that's at our door. For 40 days and 40 nights, Elijah travels until he reaches what is known as the mountain of God, Mount Horeb. Is the mountain upon which Moses, interestingly enough, was both called and given God's covenant for Israel. Perhaps here, Elijah will hear something that reignites his confidence in his call. Once at Orem, Elijah spends the night. He is awakened by the voice of God asking a beautiful question, "What are you doing here?" You know, it reminded me of the question God asked in Genesis. It was a question he already knew the answer to. The question is not for God, it's for us. Where are you? Where are you? What are you doing here? What are you doing? It was not a question of investigation, it was one to provoke introspection. In essence, God is asking, why are you at this place? Do you not know what I've called you to do? Do you not remember all that I've done to confirm your calling? Do you not remember the great works that I did before you? Why are you running from the words of one person? In other words, are you not still called? Elijah answers with all the reasons that it is acceptable for him to abandon his ministry. He has been passionate, verse 10, but the people have rejected God. The other prophets have been put to death. He's the only one left, and now they're trying to kill him as well. He, in his estimation, has failed. The death threat has undone all that God did. Why? Because his call to him was only clear when success was continual. That's a lot to think about as a denomination considering our future. His call was only clear when success was continual. And we do the same. We define the nature of our call only by our success and never by our failure. Thankfully, the Lord will not be satisfied with such silliness. He tells Elijah to step out into the presence of the Lord, verse 11, step out, for the Lord is about to pass by, and three monumental demonstrations of power take place. We've read them together already. Elijah waits for the Lord in the tearing wind. He waits for the Lord in the ground-shaking earthquake. He waits for the Lord in the roaring flame, but God was not in any of the things that he would expect him to show himself and his power through. No, it was in a gentle whisper. A whisper so slight that only silence. Y'all gotta remember, I am unbothered. We are in downtown Atlanta. I know I'm getting close to my time, Dr. Jeremiah, but I got to tell the people. I have preached in the dark because somebody stole a car and hit a power line and knocked all the power out. I have been rushed at the communion table and had to decide if I was gonna punch a man in the face in front of my congregation. I've been threatened that if this person did not get communion, they were going to blow up the whole building. Separate incidences. Walkie-talkie. That's a mild morning at our early service. That is distinctly Presbyterian. It was a gentle whisper. A whisper so slight that only silence would render it received. That is when Elijah heard the voice of God. Why? And this is something I have to tell my actual Pentecostal kids who are becoming Reformed. Because God's word through a whisper is as powerful as God's word through supernatural wonder. And here's the thing. We often miss the whisper because we're waiting for a demonstration of the power. I can't hear God, I can't hear God, I can't hear God, I pray I can't hear God. Well, because you're still listening for a burning bush. And he's talking all the time. I don't know how God talks to you all, but one time he said, if you would shut up, I could talk. Well, you said, make my request known. Well, you made them known. Now I'm trying to answer, but you're still talking. The still small voice repeats the former question, why are you here? God has fed him. God has led him. God has sent him. Why would he flee? Elijah answers back the same way, which implies, and this is the most important part of this passage, that what was really going on inside of Elijah's heart is he did not believe that God was mighty to save him. And we do that as leaders, don't we? God is good enough, strong enough, powerful enough, big enough for everybody else. But somehow his bank account is short for his shepherds. How is that possible? And that is what Elijah was feeling, that God could not save him, which made him question God's call on him. But God is not deterred in any way by Elijah's fear and depression. God's hand is on him, his call is sure. And so God tells him, go back the way you came. This is not a directional command, it's a correctional command. Go back the way you came. Fear had not canceled his calling. His fleeing had not left him forsaken. He could rise from this moment and return to the work that God set aside for him to do. I'll close here. Why does this wandering and winding story matter to us? Because according to Ephesians 2, 8 through 10, each of us is a masterpiece made by a master craftsman to perform a masterwork. And there are cycles and seasons in ministry when we lose sight of that. When we forget, when fear outweighs faith, when our judgment is clouded because of the circumstances, when our call becomes unclear to us because of an almost comical number of difficulties, because we believe God mighty to save everybody, but the shepherd he's called to serve. And so it matters to us because if you haven't been through it, you will go through it. And if you don't think you'll go through it, you'll go through it worse. And as long as we believe that only success defines the value of our call, then we'll never see value in our call. And so my message for you this evening, under the auspices of being unstoppable, is to remember that your God is unstoppable. And that you will not let difficulty derail your calling, not today, not any day. Because he that is in you is greater than he that is in the world. Because the same power that raised Christ from the dead has been poured into you. Because God gives gifts and callings without repentance. Because if he put his hand on you, then he'll finish his work through you. I could go all day if somebody get on that organ, but the bottom line is, it doesn't matter if you've gotten it all right. It doesn't matter if you doubt most days. It doesn't matter if your worth is being questioned. It doesn't matter if you've taken a few losses. It doesn't matter if you've made several mistakes. If God has called you to do something wondrous for him, then there is nothing in this world done to you or by you that can undo that calling. Period. How do we know that? Because we are in union with the perfected Christ by virtue of believing. And he promised never to leave us or forsake us. And so it is by his power that we march on. And so if you are here this evening and you feel lost, go back the way you came. If you feel unsure, go back the way you came. If you feel defeated, go back the way you came. If you feel confused, go back the way you came. If you doubt God, go back the way you came. If you fear fearful, go back the way you came. If you've lost hope, go back the way you came. If you've forgotten former victories, go back the way you came. Because there you will meet the Lord, and he will whisper to you not only who you are, but whose you are. And that will be fresh life to walk in his call for another day. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. Thank you. Gracious God and Father, we thank you for your word and the power therein. We thank you, Lord, that we are vessels through whom you speak, conduits of grace and glory, undeserving of the gift that you give in preaching the word and the joy in receiving it. And so we pray now together that we are transformed, that we do believe. Help our unbelief, that we might be those who finish the work, who do not look back, who trust the word of the Lord more than the word of the people, who lean into the faith that has been gifted and do not succumb to the fear that hangs so closely, that we might honor you with the whole of our lives and ministry, and that this denomination might fulfill its unique calling in the world. We ask these things in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. And all of God's people said,
amen.
Thank you all.
Amen. Would you please stand?